The devil gives us an injection of anesthesia. Once he told some doctors who were discussing the anesthesia they use in operations, the anesthesia of temptation is harmful to man, but the one you use is very helpful. The devil's anesthesia is like the poison certain snakes use to paralyze small birds and young rabbits so they can swallow them whole, before they have a chance to react. When the devil wants to attack a person, he first sends an assistant little devil, an anesthetist, in order to desensitize him, and then the devil himself takes over and starts pounding. But first the anesthetist has to do is his work. He gives an injection of anesthesia and we forget. Even we monks who have vowed to be reviled, to be mocked, are sometimes entangled by temptations and end up doing exactly the opposite of what we have vowed. We start out in one direction and end up somewhere else. We are not careful. Have I not told you of such examples? In the old days there was no bank in Konica. People had to go to Janina if they needed to take out a loan. So some people would start out from the nearby villages to walk 72 kilometers just to get a loan to buy. For example, a horse. In those days, having a horse was enough to provide for your family. They would join their horse with a neighbor's and would plough together. A long time ago, a man went to Janina in order to get a loan for a plough horse so that he wouldn't struggle with a hand hoe. He went to the bank to got his loan and then went to the Jewish shops to look around. The merchants saw him looking around and tried to draw him into their shops. "Come in, my good man. I have plenty of good merchandise." The man would enter the shop and the merchant would take down various bolts of fabric from the shelves for him to see. The merchant would unravel the bolt and praise the quality of the cloth. "Take it, it is good quality. For the sake of your children, I will sell it to you for less." The villager continued to look around from shop to shop. "Come in, my good man, I will sell it to you for less." Again the same routine. The merchant would take the bolts down, unravel them, and spread them out before the overwhelmed villager. In the end, the poor man was very confused and gave in. He was a simple yet honorable man. Well, he thought to himself, the merchant did take all these bolts down and promised to sell the fabric for less for the sake of my children. So he gave the loan money to buy a bolt of fabric, which wasn't even new. What would he do with so much fabric? Even a rich man wouldn't buy so much. He'd buy only as much as he needed. He returned home with a bolt of rotted fabric. "Where's the horse?" he was asked. "I brought fabric for the children," he replied. "But what can they do with so much fabric?" He was now in debt to the bank. He had no horse, and the cloth he bought had rotted from sitting on the shelf for ages. So he was once again forced to hoe the fields by hand to pay off the debt. If he had bought a horse as he had originally planned, he would have ridden home rather than walked. With a few things for the house, and most importantly, he would not need to work the fields with a hand hoe. Do you see what happened to him when he allowed himself to be distracted at the shops? This is what the devil does, like the cunning merchant. He draws you here and there, and he tricks you into going wherever he wants you to go. You can start off in one direction and end up in another if you are not careful. The devil can outwit you and make you squander your best years.